Conservative young woman, you're going to have to know the rules, you're going to have to break the rules, and you're going to have to break them beautifully, deliberately, and well. So make sure that you do that. And I want to answer your questions about whatever it is you want to ask me about. And yes, I will answer anything. So I'm going to use my last 26 minutes to do just that. I know they're going to circulate with the mic, so I will let them be the ones that choose.
Hi, Tomi.
Hi.
I kind of have a girl crush on you. I love you.
Well, thank you so much.
So last year's Young Women's Leadership Summit, which I watched from home, you said that you would be coming out with a book sometime. Is there any time we can expect that? Or
fall of 2019. That's when that's going to be out.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, of course. I appreciate you asking me that. All right. Where's your next one?
To your right.
Oh, hello.
Hi there, Tomi. My name is Eileen. I'm a huge fan.
Thank you so much.
So touching back on your point about jealousy and confidence, I currently intern at the Texas Senate, and I was working as a press intern. But unfortunately, I was told that the job had to be given to a man because it's hard to have a young, pretty woman working closely to a senator. And so, like you said, you touched a little bit on how even some conservative women will bring you down. So what advice would you give to me and all these beautiful young conservative women as we try to climb our way up to the ladder?
That's such a hard position to be in, and it's unfortunate because now it seems like it's a time where women are really empowered because of the Me Too movement, but I think that the opposite side of that is that there are a lot of men that are really worried because they can't keep it in their pants, so they take it out on women. Isn't that unfortunate? Because some men can't keep their hands to themselves, that we now have to worry if we're attractive around men. It's really unfortunate. I would say don't give up. It's unfortunate that senator in particular wouldn't accept you, but I would say don't let one person sour you. Don't let one person make you feel like it's impossible. There is someone out there. Maybe that wasn't the right one. Maybe that person was not a good person. Maybe you need to be around somebody else, so let that guide you. There's a better place for you to be, someone who's going to value you. At the end of the day, that's what you want, is to be valued for your hard work. So trust me, like I said, when you trust God's plan, every disappointment that you miss out on, it's just guiding you in a different direction. So just keep doing what you're doing. I'm sorry that happened to you. It's really unfortunate. Of course. Sure, I'm going to come out afterwards and do some signing and some pictures. All right.
Hi, Tomi. My name is Phoenix. I'm a big fan. I wanted to ask you about your experience in the Trevor Noah Show. I remember when I was in high school, my senior year, my teacher brought up the YouTube clip of your little segment with Trevor Noah, and I didn't think he treated you very well, at least on television. And I know you mentioned that Chelsea Handler was particularly very nice to you on and off camera, so I'm wondering what your experience was in the Trevor Noah Show and if he actually treated you nicely.
Here's the unfortunate part about that whole thing, because actually Trevor at first was very nice to me, and then after we were on the show, he invited me out the next night to go talk and have drinks, and of course I did that because he was kind to me, so I thought, let's go and let's have some discussions. Unfortunately, when TMZ saw that we were together talking, then people gave him flack for it, because apparently a black man can't hang out with a conservative young woman, because to them that's not allowed. That's really on them, not on us. So I believe that our party's very accepting of everyone. But then he had to distance himself from me, because in the spotlight it was like, well, why are you talking to her? It's funny how liberals are so afraid to have these conversations. Really, they are the ones that are living within a shell of themselves, because they can't even have conversations with people without their own side attacking them for having those very conversations. So, unfortunately, he cowered. And I'm proud to say that Chelsea Handler didn't. Even Bill Maher was very kind to me. There are a lot of people. I will even say Joy Behar was kind to me and wasn't afraid of the backlash. Some people aren't that strong. Sometimes you have to remember that not everyone's that strong. Actually, speaking of that, I want to share like a little personal story with you. I'm not going to mention any names, but sometimes when you do what I do and you're controversial like I am, there are some people that also have a social media following for things other than politics that really don't want to be seen with you because they're afraid that it's going to be too controversial and that they're not going to be able to sell their FabFitFun boxes, so they don't want to hang out with you and they can't sell their teeth whiteners and stuff, so they don't want to be seen with you. And at first, that happened to me quite a few times, and at first it really bothered me, and then I realized, you know what, Tomi, not everyone's as strong as you, and sometimes we have to know that. Not everyone is as strong as you, not everyone's going to be able to stand up. I think all of you in this room are strong enough, but there are going to be girls around you, and no matter what you're doing, that aren't going to be strong enough to stand up for themselves or not going to be strong enough to stand up for conservative principles and values. Don't let that make you jaded. Don't let that make you upset. Just know that sometimes people need a little extra help finding their strength, and don't hold it against them. But thank you so much for that question.
Hi.
Hi, Tomi. My name is Waverly, big fan. I started watching you when I was in high school. Loved it. I just finished up an internship in New York, which, as we know, is not super friendly to conservatives. And when they were trying to backfill my position, they were looking at hiring a new intern, they started giving preferential treatment to people because of their political stance. I only saw it because I was on the back end. And I was not as brave in my political stance because I didn't feel like I knew enough to speak to these people who were my superiors and had a different viewpoint than me. And I just remember the words said, "Can you imagine if we hired a Trump supporter?" And I'm sitting there at my desk, voted for Trump, and was terrified. And so what advice would you have for people who are looking for internships or jobs and know that they might miss out on an opportunity because of their political stance?
That's what's so hard. And like I said, not everyone is going to be as strong. I was willing to lose my job over, you know, what I believed in, and not everybody is willing to go to bat for it that much. And I don't blame you, because sometimes you're trying to get where you are in life and you worked really hard to get there. But I will say this, with everything with it almost sounds a little bit like the political Me Too movement. But I think, you know, if the liberals can stand up and say Me Too about sexual harassment and assault, why can't we stand up and say Me Too about being disenfranchised as conservatives? Why can't we stand up and expose it? Why can't we make them shake in their boots a little bit? Because they shouldn't just be afraid if they touched a girl inappropriately or they touched a guy inappropriately. That shouldn't be the only thing, because right now they're scared. They're scared everywhere, from political offices to actors to anchors to CEOs to everyone in between. The Me Too movement terrifies them, but liberal women had the ability, not all liberal, because the Me Too movement's not just liberals, but by and large liberal, they had the power to stand up and make a movement out of it. I think that if we all stand up and make a movement out of saying enough is enough about being treated differently because we're conservatives, maybe we can make people a little afraid. We did it with Facebook. We expose that, so why don't we band together and we expose? I mean, there are great organizations that do it. Turning Point USA does it. Campus Reform does it. Why don't we point out in some of these instances and band together, because there's strength in numbers? And then they can be fearful when they say things like, "Can you imagine hiring a Trump supporter?" Can you imagine if that now became an issue for them to try to marginalize and try to really humiliate, ashamed, degrade Trump supporters and conservatives? If we could turn that around on them, wouldn't that be a great use of our time? I think we should do it, because I think we can. There are 1,000 of us in this summit right now. That's a pretty good start. I know it happens every day. Thank you so much.
Hi, Tomi. So I have a question for you, and it kind of like relates to your talk about Mean Girls. So my grandpa came from Mexico City alone at 17 with $20 in his pocket. He was a hard worker, got married, raised 5 very successful kids, and is now a proud U.S. citizen. But because of his circumstances, my whole family leans to the left, some further than others. And so my question to you is, how can we show them that just because we're conservatives doesn't mean that we are not compassionate towards these people and the people that are here doing good, but without undermining our belief that the law is the law?
I think that's the hardest part about it. And there's this misnomer out there that conservatives, we hate immigrants. We don't hate immigrants. We don't hate anybody. We understand that if we weren't Americans, we would fight like hell to become Americans. But the problem is the left has really put us in a trap, because the left, for so long, because they're lenient on immigration, because they allow so many to come in illegally, they allow these people to come in illegally. Then these people live in the shadows. Then they try to grant them amnesty. And then they try to turn it on conservatives, like because we want secure borders that we're anti-immigrant. No, actually quite the opposite. We believe in respecting the rule of law. We believe in safety and security for Americans and for illegal immigrants. So we need to turn that back on them and say, listen, if you fought like hell to get in this country and you work hard, you deserve to be treated as such. You deserve to come first in this country. You deserve to come first before the illegal immigrants that don't respect the rule of law enough to follow our laws. And so it's messaging. I don't think conservatives do a good enough job at it and saying that we understand the American dream. This is not against these people. But it's about having safety and security for the people in this country, and that has to come first. That's why this president has said, with DACA, with Dreamers, he said, that's on the table, we can talk about that, but first we need to build the wall. You need to have a wall in place, and then we can talk about what happens after that. But the liberals don't want that. Absolutely not, because then they couldn't manipulate people and play them for victims anymore. That's the only way that liberals win elections, if you really think about it. They tell people that they're victims, and then they tell them that they're going to be their messiah, their hero, their savior, to get them to vote for them, and then they disappear. That's how the liberals operate. They don't really care about these people. If they did, then they'd want immigration reform. They don't care about these people. They care about votes. I don't know how many of you are from California, but there's a very disturbing trend in California. And you guys know it. So in California and a lot of other states, illegal immigrants can get driver's license. You know what happens when an illegal immigrant gets a driver's license? They automatically get put on the voter rolls. And if people don't think that voter fraud is an issue, they need to wake the hell up, because it is. And that's the first thing that we need to make sure changes. Because no matter how hard we fight, if we've got millions of illegal voters in this country, we've got dead people and illegal immigrants voting, we're never going to win an election again. All right, look how many, I have 15 minutes left.
Up front right here.
Hi, Tomi. My name is Catherine, and I hope you don't mind, but this is a bit of a personal request.
Sure.
My brother, on July 2nd, he's shipping out to South Carolina to go into boot camp to serve for the U.S. military.
All right. Congratulations to him.
And although I'm very sad, I also want him to know that I support him fully, and I'm very proud of him, so I was hoping that you could maybe wish him good luck in
Absolutely.
That.
What's his name?
Cameron Hurst.
What was it?
Cameron Hurst.
Cameron Hurst. All right, well, if Cameron's listening or if anyone's recording this, Cameron, thank you so much for voluntarily agreeing to serve and defend and protect this country. You mean the most to us, and we appreciate your service and your sacrifice. You're doing a very noble thing. So please tell Cameron that I say hello. Please tell me he's doing a great thing.
Hi, Tomi. My name is Hannah Lee, and I am from Minnesota. And it's funny because...
Well, where's the water? Because keep it away from this one. Minnesota's
well,
making me nervous
because,
now.
Well, it's funny because a week before that had happened, and I saw your the news story, the same thing actually happened to me at the Union rooftop. Were you at the
yes.
Union? Yes.
What is
so
with this place?
Same thing happened to me. Maybe it was the same girl. I'm not really sure. But so my question is... Do you ever find yourself exhausted from just the political talk and then also like the spotlight and things like that? And if so, how do you deal with it? Do you, like, for example, do a little R&R and things like that?
Well, for me, it's funny because after that incident occurred, and by the way, I was with my parents, and that wasn't the water thrown. I mean, that like wasn't the first incident that weekend. That was about the fifth. I had people coming up to me, like girls your guys' age and my age, coming up to me saying, like, when I'm with my parents, coming up and being like, F U C U N T. Like, I had that with my parents about five times that weekend, and it was disgusting. So, yeah, it gets old for sure. Then the next weekend, I was in Hermosa Beach where I live, and there was girls again, our age. One girl tried to trip me, and then she kicked me, and I'm thinking, but where am I right now? Like, how is this possibly happening? It gets old, but to me, girls like you, when I come into a room like this, I don't do it for people that kick me and throw water at me. I do it for people like you. And so if I need to take a few glasses of water thrown at me and people kicking me and calling me ugly names, that honestly, this is what I do this for. I do this for the military, I do it for law enforcement, I do it for young women. I do it for average Americans that are just working hard to live in this country and thrive in this country. So yeah, you know what, you're gonna be a target. Anytime you speak out, you're gonna be a target. Most people aren't brave enough or strong enough to do that. Don't be most people. Most people don't achieve their dreams either, so. Take it as a badge of honor. No one hunts small deer.
Okay, so we all know liberals hate to lose, but recently that's all they've really been doing. So,
very true.
I don't consider myself a victim, but I do have friends that have been victimized. My friends have been physically assaulted for being conservative. They've been stalked and exposed on their campuses. And a lot of girls that I've been talking to have told me that they're afraid to speak out in public. So my question to you is, what advice would you have for people, because some people in here are still in high school,
right,
that have problems coming out to their parents, especially if they're Democratic or not tolerant of other viewpoints?
It's really hard when it's within your family, because I would say if it's in your friend group, I always say, isn't it nice when toxic people remove themselves? It's like the trash took itself out. But when it's your family, that quite doesn't work. So. It's really hard. I would say, I know there are a lot of people that have done it. There are people that have spoken at this conference that have had to do that, and it's a tough spot to be in. But I think that you start living your life when you start living it for yourself and you be honest and authentic. When it comes to safety issues, though, I mean, I can only imagine. It's true. People are being assaulted. They are being attacked. Know your audience. Know your place. I would also say, too, we have to be smart. We have to be out smoking, but we have to be smart. I don't go into a crowd of people when, you know, I'm alone, and I don't, like, go around waving my mega hat at people and starting to, like, roll some final thoughts out. Like, I know my audience, you know? Like, when I'm at LAX, I don't stand at the baggage claim and be like, hey, everybody, guess how I feel about Colin Kaepernick? I just know that's probably not going to be a real safe environment for me. So you have to make sure that you know where you are, because safety is most important. But, you know, if you find a group of people and you feel like you're in a place that you can speak up for yourself and stand your ground, you're always going to be better off doing so. But, you know, be smart out there, guys. Don't go looking for a fight either. That's where we fail every time, is when we go out there trying to stir up. I mean, that's what the liberals do. Like, they literally pay people to do that. We can't do that. That's not a good look for us. But, you know, I'm sorry that your friends had to go through that. It's going to change, though, I promise you. There are going to be so many more people coming over to our side. Look at everything this president's doing. It's really hard to argue with lower taxes, world peace, with, you know, a secure border, with an empowered military. It's really hard to argue with all those things, no matter who you are. So I think you're going to see a lot more people coming over to our side. It's important that we spread the message and we make sure that the narrative is corrected, because then I think we might not have that problem anymore. So we're going to chip away at it slowly. But thank you so much for your question.
Hi. I'm from Kansas, and I just found out today that two deputies were shot in a county right near mine, and I just found out that one of them died. We're not sure what the reasoning was, but I am a huge Blue Lives Matter supporter, thin blue line, everything. And I just want to know, what's your advice? Like, what can I do? Because now it could possibly be coming into my home, and that's not something I want. What can I do to help further the Blue Lives Matter movement in my county?
The thing about police officers is, you know, they're so selfless. They do what they do for little money. They do it for horrible hours. They sacrifice really everything to keep our streets safe. They go into neighborhoods that they don't want to be in. You know, they don't show up there because they necessarily want to be there. They show up there because that's their job, and they protect the very people that claim to hate them. That's why I find it so disgusting when people like John Legend say the things that he says in this anti-cop narrative that I believe was started by our previous president. That's why I find it so disgusting. We can't protect police officers because they protect us. What we can do is show our appreciation and our support, because I'll tell you, because I speak to so many of them, knowing that they have the support out there, knowing that they're not doing what they're doing for nothing, means the world to them. And so if you see a police officer and you thank them, I mean, oftentimes we do that with members of the military, we do it with veterans. I think it's so important in this country right now to do it with our police officers. So just showing your support and appreciation, I think, means the world to them.
Thank you.
And those of you with law enforcement in your families, I think you guys know that. Sometimes they just feel like monsters and demons, and it's so hard because they feel like they're being hated in the very communities they go to protect. But it's, to me, if we can just show a little bit of appreciation, that can really change the course of somebody's day. So I hope we can all do that and be vocal about it. All right. Sorry, I don't see my... I only have a little bit. Hello.
Hi, Tomi. Sorry. You're my role model, first of all.
Well, thank you so much. I appreciate that. I'm sorry for my foul language.
No, you're
I right. apologize to my dad about that on a daily basis.
I wanted to say that I'm Summer Basham, future president.
All right.
So I know that conservative speakers like you get treated horribly. Like, I know you and Ben Shapiro often get invited to go speak at events, and protesters will come up and not let you speak in the first place. So in cases like that, when they're not letting you speak in the first place, how do you kind of combat that and get your message across?
Well, I think we've been doing a great job of exposing it. I mean, that happened to me. I had a tour date in Philly, and they were protesting, and they had signs, and they vandalized the theater. And, you know, I dealt with that, but I actually went out there, and I approached a lot of they wouldn't let me go across the street, but I tried to speak to them, and it's just trying to calm people down, trying to, I think Charlie does a great job of this as well, is trying to have people understand that the First Amendment is so powerful and that free speech is so powerful, and you can listen to somebody or choose not to listen to somebody, but you don't have to silence them. I think most liberals, even if they are screaming and they're mad and they're enraged, it's because they've been taught to do that. And if we can calm them down, which is what I was trying to do with the girl that threw the water at me, if we can try to calm them down and de-escalate the situation, it works in our favor. But other than that, I think being able to go out and find other ways of doing, that's why social media is so powerful as well, is that sometimes we don't have to go to those areas, we can put it on social media, and then through that, through the support of others, through support of people like you in this room, we can combat that and we can make sure that we are allowed to speak. So. And again, I hear a lot, and I don't like ever feeling like a victim, like, Jesus, I got water thrown at me. It's not the end of the world. It's not a big deal. But I think that by playing the victim, we're hurting ourselves when we sit here and be like, oh, yeah, it's so hard for me when I have to go speak on college campuses. Listen, I'm living my dream. I'm blessed. I have people that are nasty and disgusting to me, but I'm far more blessed than I am antagonized. So, and if you become this and you do this, don't even let it bother you, because you're living your dream and it's going to come at a price. We can't, you know, we don't live perfect lives. We're not Bernie Sanders, so. All right.
Hi, Tomi. My name's Kendall. I'm a California native, and I just turned 18 like 2 months ago. So first thing I did was register to vote. I got out there and I got my sample ballot in the mail. Did my research on every little proposition, every little candidate, and I was a huge Travis Allen fan.
I was as well.
Yeah.
I was as well.
Yeah. I was wondering, what is your advice for a California conservative, and how have you lasted through the hate, the name calling, the
Oh, we're
going to
take California back. I'm
oh,
telling
yes, girl.
You, it's coming. Woo! California is rising up, let me tell you, because I see it every single day. It's really hard to tell people that they should have a primary and secondary excise tax on gasoline. It's really hard to get people to believe that that's in their best interest. It's really hard to get people to believe that illegal immigrants deserve medical and dental care. That's a really hard one to pass, Gavin Newsom. Mm-hmm. So we just need to get the message out, because Californians aren't stupid. They might be liberal. They might be all the things that a lot of us in this room are not. But a lot of them are not stupid. If you live in California, you're either very rich or you're probably very poor. But the ones that are very rich or the ones that are still struggling to be in the middle, they're not stupid. And they're seeing what's happening, and they're seeing that home prices are through the roof, rent prices are through the roof, it costs so much to live in California. Mm-hmm. How do you have the fifth largest economy in the world and have the highest poverty rate and the biggest disparity between rich and poor? How do you do that? Liberals is how you do that. Yep. Jerry Brown is how you do that. California, let California be the prime example of what not to be, guys, because that's what happens when liberalism goes crazy. They go so far to the left.
Yep.
But people are waking up because they made a mistake. They push people so far that now they're starting to turn the other way. So let's take advantage of it. I was a Travis Allen fan as well, but right now we need to put our energy behind Cox, because that's really the only hope that we have in California. It's bad. It's really bad.
All right, this is going to be the last question.
All right. Better be a good one, no pressure.
Hi, Tomi. I've been a big, huge fan of you for years now. But I wanted to touch on a little bit of a controversial subject.
Sure.
In terms of what most conservative women believe. How do you deal with the backlash whenever it's coming from someone who would normally agree with you on everything else that you stand for? I personally thought that what you said on The View last year, I think 2 years ago, was courageous, and it was exactly what needed to be said at the time and moment. But I've had a lot of people in my personal life say, oh my gosh, I can't support her because of that.
Sure. Well, let's talk about that. Let's clear that up, because I think it's so important. And last time when I was at SAS, I had some people that thought that it would be classy and respectful of them to scream it at me, which I don't respond to people that scream things at me. I tune that out. It's white noise to me at this point. It sounds like Hillary. I don't hear it. But anyway, let's address that, because I think that's what's so important. A lot of you in this room, I assume, are a lot of pro-life in this room, and that's fantastic. Good for you. Congratulations to you. No, and me personally, am I personally pro-life? Absolutely. Would anybody in that situation, would I counsel anybody, any of my friends, myself personally? Yeah, absolutely, I'm pro-life. Absolutely, I believe in the same things that you believe in. I'm a Christian conservative. So absolutely, I'm pro-life. However, I will say this. I am not pro-choice in that I believe that abortion is the right way to go. I, however, don't believe that the government has a place. And when people say, oh, well, they should, it's protecting a life, I understand that argument, and I believe that that's a valid argument, but let me tell you where I stand on that issue. I don't believe that the government does anything well. I don't think that the government does healthcare well. I don't think the government runs its institutions well. I don't think the bureaucracy does things well. So I think when you have a young girl or a girl or whatever in that position where she's facing the most difficult moment of her life, the most traumatic experience she's probably ever gone through, I think that when we treat those people with compassion, that's how we make them pro-life. We don't do it through government intervention, because I believe that when the government intervenes, just like when we talk about gun rights, I believe when the government intervenes in matters like that, I don't believe that it stops people from doing horrible things. I think that it allows them to do it on the outside and do it in a way that's not as safe, do it in a way that hurts them, hurts others, and eventually I believe that they're going to carry out what they want to carry out regardless. So I believe instead of reaching out to those people and saying you're a baby killer or yelling at them or shouting them down, I believe the best way that we can make them believe in life and be pro-life is treat them with compassion and use our Christianity or whatever religion that we believe in to do it in that way. I don't believe that the government does it as good as we do. So that is why when I say I'm pro-choice, that's what that means. To clear it up. To clear it up. Because I know a lot of you wonder that about me, and I know a lot of you, you know, people have shouted that at me, and I lost my job over it. I never got a chance to clarify it. I never got a chance to go back on my show and tell exactly what I felt and exactly what I meant. That was taken from me. But guess what? I'm on Fox News now, so I guess it worked. But don't be, when conservative, when we go after each other like that, I think it's horrible. I don't know why we do it. If you want to have a conversation with somebody, have that conversation with them and have a disagreement with them and talk about the merits of each other's argument, but don't scream at people. Don't dismiss people. Don't tell people that they're not conservative enough. They're not Republican enough. Who is to decide what is conservative and Republican enough? Because I will remind you how many people told us that our now president was not conservative enough. Do you remember that? Because I do. I remember so many Never Trumpers saying that this president wasn't conservative enough, and he's doing all the things that we as conservatives believe in. So don't let people shout you down. Don't let people make you feel ashamed for what you believe in. Have the arguments, have the discussions. I think that that's what makes this country great. I think that's what makes the conservative movement so great. So excellent last question. You succeed. Thank you so much. Thank you, guys. I'm going to go play this one later. Play. Shake.